your seats. I'm going to invite you to take your Bibles or your Bible apps and turn to the Gospel of John, chapter 19. John 19 is our text today as we're continuing our Last Words series. If you don't have a Bible with you or a Bible app on your device, that's fine. Grab one of the Bibles in the seats around you. Turn to page 1076, and you will find our text today. And as always, if you're here and you don't have a Bible and you want a Bible, you want to read God's Word, then this is a gift from us. Just take one of these with you when you go, and if you'll use it, we'll bless you with one of these. I know a lot of people have said to me, it just feels wrong. It feels like I'm stealing a Bible. You're not stealing it because we're giving it to you. And that's just our offer because we know if you read God's Word, it will change your life. Hey, speaking of life and following up on what Julie was sharing earlier, today is our life group signups, and if you are not in a life group, I want to encourage you to check it out. We've got life groups meet all different kinds of times, and life groups are awesome. It's an opportunity for you to really connect with people and experience what I call real church. You know, because this is like a bunch of people in a room, and we're all together, and we're singing and praising and learning together. But life group is where you connect your life, and people get to know you, you get to know them. You share your struggles, they share theirs, you help one another, you encourage one another, you teach one another, and you do life together, you know, the tough stuff, but also the fun stuff, and you play together. Friday night, we were at the movies with our life group, or some of our life group, and we ran into another life group that was going to a movie. They were being more spiritual than us. They were going to see The Shack. We were not, Logan. But it's just a great thing to stop by the tables, check it out, and sign up because God will use that to change your life. And speaking of movies and The Shack, I've been asked by several people, you know, should we go see that? Because there's a lot of stuff out there. If you are connected to any of the Christian community on social media and stuff, there's all kinds of people saying, well, you know, The Shack is not theologically correct and things like that. And I agree. The Shack is not a theological book. It is a therapeutic book, and I happen to like it as that. But let me just say this for the record. I'm not somebody who tells people to go to movies or not to go to movies. I'll tell you what I like. But here's the thing. If you go to movies to get theology, you're going to the wrong place. Okay? If you want to understand God and who He is and how He works in the world, then I encourage you to read the book. Okay? That's the Bible. We believe the Bible is the inerrant, inspired Word of God that tells us what to believe and how to live. And so this is where we go to get our theology. Go to movies to be entertained or to be encouraged or whatever. Hang out with your friends even if you don't like the movie. I don't care. But that's my take on that. Understand what things are and what they are not, and we're a whole lot better off. So getting back to the message, what's the rudest question you've ever been asked? You know, that kind of question where you just automatically want to say, that is none of your business. What do you need to know that for? You know, you don't have any right to ask me that. What's the rudest question you've been asked? You've got 10 seconds to share it with your friends right around you. Ready, set, go. Rudest question. Some of you don't take this opportunity to ask the rudest question. Ask them what the rudest question was. Okay, some of you are having more fun than others. Some of you apparently haven't been asked enough rude questions. So if that's the case, we need to get together. I need to visit with you because I'll ask them. By the way, this is a great kind of question that you can talk about in your life group with your friends and find out what other rude questions. But here's some of those questions that as I ask people, hey, what's the rudest question you've ever been asked? These are some of the ones we came up with. For instance, how much do you weigh? Yeah. No real positive spin to put on that unless you're in a doctor's office or, you know, getting ready to fly on a small airplane. How about this? How old are you? And if you are older, you shouldn't really care anymore because you're still alive. How about this? Is that your real hair color? Yes, by the way, it is my real hair color. I'm good with that. Or how about this? How much do you make? Followed by, is that all? Or is that the best you can afford? Or how much did you pay for that? That's a good, when was your last shower? That's a good one. I didn't have that one written down. I'll add it to the list. Or how about this one? Who dressed you? Or who picked out your clothes? Or the variation of that, which is not a question but rather a statement, really, in question form, is that what you're going to wear? And if you're a husband, that means you're not wearing that. See, what happens when people ask us questions that we consider rude or invasive, we kind of have one or two reactions to that. Either we're going to put up a wall and literally say, none of your business, and we're going to push that person away, or we're actually going to decide to answer the question, and we're going to allow things to get personal. We're going to let them into our personal space. We're going to share with them knowledge that we don't think is common knowledge or for everyone to know. And those are the kind of the two options that we have. And as we're continuing our last word series, today we're looking at a text where Jesus gets personal. It's not a grand statement on forgiveness. It's not a dramatic shout of victory or a painful cry. It's simply Jesus letting us in, letting us see him and really see us in the midst of this. It begins with two revealing words, and we're going to find those in the text, John 19, beginning at verse 26. Let me just remind you, we're looking at the things Jesus said while he was being crucified, while he's dying, his last words on the cross. And so already he has been at the Last Supper, he's been in the garden, he's been betrayed and arrested and tried and condemned and mocked and beaten. And now he is on the cross. And it says in verse 26, when Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, woman, behold your son. And then he said to the disciple, behold your mother. And from that hour, the disciple took her to his own home. After this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said, in order to fulfill the scriptures, I thirst. A jar full of sour wine stood there, so they put a sponge full of the sour wine on a hyssop branch and held it to his mouth. Two revealing words. The first one is simply, woman, behold your son, and literally, son, behold your mother. Now, by the way, for the ladies, that expression, woman, behold your son, woman who is not like being rude to his mom, that was a common term used for females in your family, and so it wasn't like he's going, hey, woman. It was a term of endearment, if you will. And so Jesus is saying to Mary, listen, see who I am, see where I am, see what has happened. Because Jesus has been betrayed, he's been accused, he's been mocked, he's been beaten, tortured, humiliated. Now he's in the midst of suffering and agonizing death. And his mom and his closest disciple, by the way, if you haven't figured this out, his closest disciple is John. But John doesn't ever name himself in his gospel. He always refers to himself in some other way. The disciple whom Jesus loved is the usual way. He does that several times in his gospel. So they're there watching. And they're grieving and they're in shock because none of this was what they expected to happen. They weren't expecting Jesus to end up on a cross. It had never occurred to them that it was a possibility. And Jesus speaks into their lives. To Mary, Jesus says, see what is happening. Mom, this is real. Don't live in denial. And go ahead and acknowledge that this isn't what you wanted, but here I am, your son, and I'm dying. He didn't want her to reject the truth. He wanted her to embrace the truth, even though it was painful. And to John, he says, take care of my mom. Take care of my mother. And in the midst of his suffering, Jesus fulfills his family responsibility. Think about that. He's the oldest son. His stepfather, Joseph, is dead. Jesus is charged with caring for his mom. And so he arranges her care and her provision while he's in the midst of suffering. Now, I know some of you are thinking, didn't Jesus have brothers? Yes, he had brothers. But at this point in time, his brothers were not yet followers. In fact, his brothers and his mom had come to him earlier in his ministry and said, basically, for all intents and purposes, Jesus, you're crazy. You need to come home. We've got a nice padded room to lock you in for a little while. You know, you can just, you know, kind of chill and regain your senses because you're kind of acting crazy. And so Jesus didn't trust his brothers with the care of his mom. He trusted it to his disciple, whom he knew would honor and respect. Now, Jesus also knew the resurrection was coming, but he also understood that he was only going to be here for a short time. So he wanted to go ahead and take care of those details because he knew he was going to ascend to heaven. So think about this. Jesus kept the commandment that he gave. Honor your father and your mother. Jesus kept the commandment. And honoring your father and your mother means that he shows respect, but he cares for them when they're old, when they need help, when they cannot care for themselves. And I want you to see that this is a beautiful example that Jesus is showing us of what it means to honor your parents. One thing I've noticed is that when you're in pain, when people are in pain, there's a tendency to get selfish and to get mean in the pain. That a lot of times we get overwhelmed by the intense pain, whether it's chronic pain, whether it's physical pain, whether it's emotional pain, relational pain, it's grief. We get overwhelmed by that pain and we kind of turn inward. And so a lot of times we can just kind of take that out on the people closest to us. And we lash out and we hurt them. And Jesus shows us another way. He says, you don't have to do it that way. Even though he is in the midst of intense pain, he shows compassion. And he wants us to know that we are never alone in our pain. We're never alone in our pain. God is there with us, and he understands that suffering. He understands that pain. And the Apostle Paul gives us words to kind of put things in perspective. Romans 8:18, the Apostle Paul, who is no stranger to pain himself, says this, I do not consider our present sufferings worth comparing to the glory that will be revealed in us in Christ Jesus. In other words, Paul says, look, keep it in perspective. Whatever pain you're in is temporary. But because of Jesus, soon there's going to come a day when all this pain that you've been through in this world, you're going to forget about it because God himself is going to wipe your tears from your eyes and you're going to step into a world of perfection that is free of that kind of suffering and that kind of hurt. That's the promise of Christ. And Jesus wants us to be filled with that and to know that no matter how bad it hurts, you're not alone. So, woman, behold your son. Son, behold your mother. And then Jesus said, I thirst. Now, besides fulfilling prophecy, and by the way, the prophecy is Psalm 69:21, if you want to look it up, I do find it encouraging that Jesus actually references the Psalms several times in his statements from the cross. Several times he either quotes directly or references the prophecies in the Psalms, which, again, is one of the reasons that I really encourage you to know Scripture, to read Scripture, to memorize Scripture, because in those moments of pain, then Scripture can come out of your heart, can come out of your mind. It can fill the air, if you will, with hope and references. But besides fulfilling that prophecy, what's the point? I mean, Jesus is in agony, he's hurting, he's in pain, and, oh, by the way, he's thirsty. In that moment, we clearly see the weakness and frailty of Jesus' body. And we can relate to that. I mean, after all, how many of us have been thirsty at some point in our lives? Oh, come on. You guys live in the desert. You've been thirsty. People didn't raise their hands. Like, no, I've never been thirsty. I never get more than 3 feet from my water bottle, so I'm good. Yeah, you've been thirsty. How many of you have ever been in pain or been grieving a loss? See, that's all of us. So has your Savior. Which leads us to that question, why are these statements recorded? I mean, you know, these are really, really different than the other statements in the Gospels. But these statements are here to teach us. And something you may not know or may not understand, but the first three Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, were all written earlier than the Gospel of John. Matthew, Mark, and Luke, depending on which scholar you read, and by scholars, I mean people who actually believe the Bible and want to represent it, believe that they were written between, you know, the 50s and 70s A.D. John was written about 20 years later, in the 90s A.D. And it was a little bit different world when John wrote his gospel, and things were happening, and so he wanted to be really specific in what he's teaching us. And he wants to share some things. He wants us to get some things. And one of the things that John wants is to teach us about Jesus' divinity and his humanity. John wants us to understand Jesus was divine and human. In other words, Jesus was fully God and fully human. I know, let that sink in for a minute, because that doesn't necessarily sound like it's possible. Jesus was fully God and he was fully human. And in saying that, it means that there was no one else like Jesus. Jesus is the one and only Son of God. If you grew up on King James, it means only begotten Son of God. And Jesus is unique. There's never been anyone like him, and there never will be anyone like Jesus. Now, he wasn't a man who became a God. He wasn't somebody who was just doing well and God chose him. He was eternal God in the flesh. And this is important to John that we understand this, because in John's time that he wrote this gospel, there was a heresy, a false teaching that was going around, and it was threatening the church. And John is confronting that false teaching. The false teaching is something that was called Gnosticism. Gnosticism, and if you're going to Google it, it starts with a G, not an N, okay? Gnosticism was a heresy that basically took some Greek thought and tried to mix it with Christianity. And so here's what they said. They said you're basically saved by knowledge. Gnosticism, Gnostic, is taken from the Greek word gnosis for knowledge. And so he said, you're basically saved by what you know, not by what Jesus did on the cross, not by his shed blood and his sacrifice for us. And they believed that, and they taught that, because Gnostics believed that all flesh was evil and all spirit was good. And so they believed that since all flesh was evil, that Jesus didn't really have a body. That he would just look like he had a body, but he was just a spirit walking around. And therefore, since he didn't really have a body, he didn't really die on the cross, and he didn't really shed blood. And so that's why you're saved by what you know, not by Jesus. And John wants us to understand, all of the readers that he's writing to understand that this is wrong. He wants us to see Jesus as a man who got thirsty. A man who had real relationships with a real mom. And that's why Jesus wrote in his gospel, John chapter 1, verse 1, in the beginning was the Word. And when he talks about the Word, he's talking about Jesus. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that has been made. In him was life, and that life is the light of men, and the light shines in the darkness. And the darkness cannot even comprehend it. A few verses later, same chapter, he says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. He said, I want you to see Jesus is fully God. He's there eternal, but he's also fully human. He became flesh and lived with us. And walked with us and died for us. Now, if that's not clear enough, flip over to John, 1 John, the first letter that he wrote. 1 John chapter 4. If you've got a Bible like me, it's page 1212. That's easy, isn't it? 1212. Way back toward the back of the book. 1 John 4, beginning in verses 1 through 3. Listen to what he says. He says, Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God, for many false prophets have gone out into the world. Kind of sounds like he's writing this today, doesn't it? By this you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God. And every spirit that does not confess Jesus is not from God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you heard was coming and now is in the world already. He says, look, I want you to get this. Jesus Christ is unique. There's no one else like Jesus. He is eternal God, and he was born into this world of a virgin named Mary, miraculously conceived by the Holy Spirit. He lived his life on this earth as a man without ever yielding to temptation. He died on the cross, and in his death he paid for our rebellion, our defiance, our sin, and he was gloriously raised from the dead and is now King of Kings and Lord of Lords and has defeated sin and death and hell. John goes, I want you to see Jesus. I want you to know Jesus because this is the gospel. There is no other gospel. There is no other way. There is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved other than the name Jesus. And John writes us this gospel and he shows us this picture because he wants us to understand Jesus and he wants us to know Jesus and he wants us to know the truth about Jesus because this is the gospel that can change your life. The Apostle Paul said, if anyone comes preaching another gospel, let him be anathema, literally cut off from humankind. And so today I have to ask you this question because this is the most important question anyone will ever ask you in this world. Have you experienced that life-changing relationship with Jesus Christ? Have you come to the place where you understand Jesus has forgiven your sins, you acknowledge he's the one and only Son of God and Savior of the world, and you believe that he has risen from the dead, and you've committed yourself to following him, even to the point, like these girls did today, of saying, hey, Jesus is my Savior and I want the world to know it. Because just going to church isn't going to change your life. Being a good person isn't going to change your life. Trying to be good enough so you make it to heaven isn't going to change your life. But coming to Jesus and saying, I need you to save me, will change your life and your eternity. If you're not sure that you have that relationship with Jesus Christ, then please, at the end of the service, would you find one of our prayer team members here at the front and talk with him? Come out to one of the welcome centers and find one of the pastors. Allow us to walk with you on this journey. We want you to know Jesus. John wants you to know Jesus. And then John wants to show us Jesus understands us and is for us. Jesus understands us and is for us. I want to reference another passage in the book of Hebrews this time, chapter 4, page 1189, if you got a book like mine. This passage is for everyone who really struggles with the idea that God is for you. Maybe you struggle with the idea that you just have been too evil, too wicked, too trapped in your sin, and you really think that God is put out with you, that he's angry at you, that he's frustrated with you, that he's tired of your stuff. If that's you, if you've struggled with that, then you need to mark this passage, highlight this passage, let this passage become yours. You need to visit it often because this is a passage of hope for us. Listen to what the writer of Hebrews says. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession. What's our confession? That Jesus is the one and only. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Did you catch that? Jesus understands us. Jesus understands you. Because he lived on this earth as a man, he walked this earth as a person like you and I, he has faced every single temptation, and yet he won. So guys, let me just speak to you for a minute. That means that Jesus understands the temptation of lust that we face. Only he actually won the battle. And so when you're facing that battle, guys, Jesus isn't disgusted by you. He wants to come alongside you and give you victory. Jesus faced the battle for all of us with pride. And overcame pride. And just imagine how this, because none of us like being told that we're wrong when we're right. And our pride wells up, and we want to say, like, if I'd been Jesus, let me just tell you guys wouldn't have been saved. Wouldn't have happened, because, you know, when I'm standing there in front of those high priests that are, you know, mocking him and accusing him of blasphemy, and they ask him the question, are you the Son of God? And he says, yes, I am. And they rip their clothes and call out blasphemy and everything because he told them the truth. I'd have fried them right there. I just would have happened, because my pride, he is like, forget it, man. Just blow up right there, just, you know, waste them all. And you would have done the same thing, because we're Christian. But Jesus, you know, he fought that battle and he won that battle. And it doesn't matter if it's with gluttony or if it's with greed or if it's with envy or jealousy. Jesus understands what you're going through. He understands the temptation and he won. But he sympathizes with us. He gets us. He also knows the pain of loss. You know, he buried his stepfather. He grieved at the tomb of a friend. He understands the grief you're feeling. He knows the sting of betrayal. He knows the frustration of faithless and clueless friends. He knows what it is to be questioned by his family. I told you that his family came literally to take him home and lock him up because they said he was crazy. I'm sure that none of you have ever had your family accuse you of being crazy. Ever. Couldn't happen. But if it did, Jesus understands. Jesus also knows the indignation of being falsely accused. I mean, is there anything more frustrating than that? And yet Jesus has experienced it. He gets us. He knows hunger and thirst. He knows exhaustion and loneliness. He knows the fear of pain and its reality. He's been through the dying process and he's tasted death. Jesus understands us. And guess what? Jesus is for us, which means that Jesus is for you. You. God is for you. He is our advocate, our high priest, who's waiting for us to come to him and admit our weaknesses, our struggles, our failures, our faults, so that he can help us. And when we come to him, what does Scripture promise us? That we're going to find grace. Abundant grace, amazing grace. It's going to pour out into our lives. And Jesus is waiting for us to come in our weakness, because that's what confession is. Confession is not just admitting that you've screwed up. Confession is acknowledging, hey, I'm a weak person, and here's my failures, and here's my faults, and here's my struggles, and here's where I need help. Because if we don't ask for help, then our pride is winning. And Jesus doesn't come and help us when we're proud. The grace is available when we come to that throne of mercy and we ask God to help us, which means that we have to stop pretending that we've got our stuff together. And again, ladies, I don't know how you feel, but I know a lot of guys, we want to be tough. We want to be strong. We don't want to be little girly men. We want to make it on our own. We want to prove how tough we are. We want to prove that we don't need help. I can do it myself, all that kind of stuff. And that just gets in the way. Sometimes we come to church and we think, yeah, you know, I'm not going to let you know that I'm hurting, I'm struggling, I'm weak, because I got to look like we got it all together. Whether it's your marriage, your family, your job, your personal stuff, what you're thinking on the inside, Jesus invites us to be broken and weak with him, because he showed us himself broken and weak for us. And he wants to be your advocate. He wants to help you. He knows your weaknesses. He knows your addictions. He knows your hidden desires. He knows your anger, your resentments. He knows all that stuff you're holding on to. And he invites you to come to him, confessing it all to him, promising forgiveness and healing and hope. But we're afraid to. See, Jesus knows what it is to be broken. And he is not afraid of your brokenness, and he is not annoyed with your brokenness. Even though some of you, and I know how the prayer goes, you know, you sin, and then you repent, and you say, God, I'll never do that again. And then you do it again. And you say, God, I really never will do it again, and you do it again. And you repent, and you do that. And after a while, you kind of go, God must be sick and tired of me. Sick and tired of me, just coming back all the time, over and over and over again, with the same basic prayer of repentance, because I keep screwing up the same way over and over and over again. And here's the thing, God's not annoyed with you. He is not sick and tired of you. He loves you, and he wants to see you have victory. He wants to see you overcome. He wants you to come to him, and he'll wrap you up in his arms, and he'll take hold of you, and he'll just let you know, hey, you're my child, and I love you. Because when you're weak, I'm strong. And I will forgive you again and again and again. So come and lay your burdens down and let me give you new life. It just all begins when we meet Jesus at the cross and we surrender. But to get there, understand what has to happen. We have to let Jesus get close. We have to let Jesus have some conversations with us that we don't want to have. We have to let Jesus go ahead and ask us about those details of our life that we really don't want to discuss with God. We have to decide to let Jesus in. And a lot of us, honestly, when things get a little bit uncomfortable here, which, by the way, when they get uncomfortable here, that means the Holy Spirit's like messing with you. He wants to talk. Are you going to put the wall up and say, hey, I don't want to talk about this. It's none of your business. Hey, if you belong to Jesus, it is his business. But he'll honor that. He'll honor that. He'll let you put up the wall and go on in your pain and your sorrow and your suffering alone. He doesn't want you to be alone. He wants to go ahead and deal with it. And so the question is, are you going to let Jesus in when he gets rude and ask you what you don't want to answer? Or are you going to push him away? He got personal with us. I challenge you to let him in. Let him get personal with you. Because he is for you and he understands you. Let's pray.